If the government is borrowing more, it's not really borrowing more. What it's really done is it's spent more than it taxes through data entry, and it's just decided to sell us debt, which it calls borrowing. So it creates this image, as you know, that a household, that the government's somehow having to take money from us. It's not borrowing money from that sense. It's already spent it. We've got the money in the form of bank reserves, the non-government sector has, and it's swapping that for debt and calling it borrowing. It's describing something entirely wrongly and creating the wrong impression.
This is the MMT Podcast with Patricia Pino and Christian Riley. Hi, I'm Christian Riley, and welcome to the Modern Monetary Theory Podcast. You can find us on Twitter at MMT Podcast, and you can support the show by going to patreon.com/MMT Podcast. If this is your first time hearing about MMT, you might want to listen to our first three episodes for an introduction, which I've linked to in the show notes, along with some other things that relate to this particular episode. And as ever, I've linked to where you can support this podcast financially via patreon.com/MMT Podcast. Support starts at $1 a month or £1 a month or whatever the equivalent is wherever you live. And no matter what level of support you give, you get early access to all of our episodes and patron-only episodes where you can ask me and Patricia MMT questions. We're 100% listener funded. Your financial support really helps keep the show going, and your support in other ways, whether it's by recommending us to other people or just by listening and spreading the word about this stuff, really helps too. A big thank you to all of our supporters so far, and thanks as ever for the time you put into understanding MMT. Let's dive in. Welcome one and all to the MMT Podcast. I'm Christian Riley.
And I'm Patricia Pino.
And we are delighted, as ever, to welcome back MMT scholar and author, Dr. Phil Armstrong. Hi, Phil.
Hi, you both. Great to be back again with you.
So at the time of recording, it's the least wonderful time of year for MMT advocates because it's budget day. And for people who are new to MMT, I'll explain why it's frustrating. It's because most of MMT is a description of how governments spend, how the payment system actually operates in a country where the government issues its own floating exchange rate currency, such as the UK, the US, Japan, Canada, Poland, Australia. There's many more, but time is limited. And the key insight for right now, putting it as briefly as possible, is that the governments in countries like these create new money when they spend. I'll say it again, they create new money when they spend. In the UK, the government spends by changing numbers on a spreadsheet using a computer keyboard at a central bank. The UK government spends pounds into existence, or going a step earlier in the sequence, the government passed legislation mandating some spending. And from that point, that money is going to be spent into existence. Nothing can stop that institutionally. Government checks don't bounce. The Bank of England doesn't get to turn around and say, sorry, we've run out of money, because running out of money is completely inapplicable when you spend by adjusting balances on a spreadsheet. So you could say that Parliament votes pounds into existence. So the government can and does spend without operational limit. And of course, every bit of spending will have consequences, maybe positive consequences, maybe negative consequences. But the government running out of money is not one of those consequences. So budget day is the worst time of year for people who understand this reality, because politicians of all ideologies, the media, the chattering classes, every man, woman, and right-wing concrete grows on trees believing silly Billy spends the day talking as if this wasn't the case and reinforcing the narrative that the government is just like a household having to collect money before it can spend it, when in reality, the government is the source of the money that it spends. So that said, apart from the customary appalling media framing of it, Patricia, I'll turn to you first. Do you have any overarching comments about Chancellor Rishi Sunak's budget today?
Well, the main criticisms have been that there hasn't been anything mentioned about action on climate change. In fact, there were tax breaks for short-haul flights. On top of that, they've increased the minimum wage to $9.50, but I believe some groups have already pointed out that this in no way makes up for the cut in universal credit. So overall, you know, working people at a loss. But those are pretty good criticisms. You know, the overarching feel about the budget was how finances were continued to be spoken about like it was a household. I mean, some statements from Rishi Sunak was that if you borrow too much, you know, eventually it leads to increased interest rates. So highlighting the importance of keeping the government debt down. However, there isn't any academic kind of evidence of this actually happening. He also, actually quite importantly, the Tories seem to have copied John McDonnell's fiscal credibility rule or something very similar.
Yeah, yeah.
It was funny because I think it was Paul Mason who highlighted this on Twitter, almost as a means of saying, oh, we were right. That's why the Tories are taking on this rule. But actually, I wouldn't find that to be such a flattering thing.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. He kind of doesn't know he's owning himself there.
Well, if the Tories are taking this on, my view is it's because it doesn't actually get in the way of the austerity agenda.
Exactly, yeah. In fact, helps it.
Yeah, and any fiscal credibility rule, no matter how lenient you believe it to be, what it's doing is it's putting the fiscal balance above every other priority in your economy, right? And that in itself, that is wrong in my view. So that's my key takeaway.
Yeah, Rishi Sunak started by emphasizing growth up, jobs up, and debt down. So, you know, he's giving himself a pat on the back there. And obviously that last bit, debt down, means, you know, to him that's good. And he goes on then to say, and you touched on it there, Patricia, but this is the quote, quote, coronavirus left us with borrowing higher than at any time since the Second World War. As the Prime Minister reminded us in his conference speech, higher borrowing today is just higher interest rates and even higher taxes tomorrow. Now, he's quoting the Prime Minister there. Now, if I was in charge of, like, you know, big important numbers, I wouldn't defer to the Prime Minister, a person who can't actually count his own children. But anyway, putting that to one side, Phil, just on the macro side, higher borrowing today is just higher interest rates and even higher taxes tomorrow. That's not quite right, is it?
No, not quite right. You're being quite generous, really. Not at all right. I mean, one of the difficulties, I think, oh, there's so many difficulties, as you both know well, the idea of, you know, the top, we are in debt. Now, what actually they try to do from the outset is somehow, just in this case, because normally the government are very different to the rest of us. You know, like the Thatcherite mantra is the people are great, you know, they should be free, and the government gets in the way. So if you're a Thatcherite, there's a very strong distinction between the government and the people, ordinary people. The ordinary people will certainly not be the we with the government. But when it comes to government debt, apparently that's our inverted commas debt. Now, obviously, this is quite a big mistake because at the end of the day, I mean, let's imagine that in year naught, you know, there's no money and the government spends 100 million. As you pointed out in your introduction, it's about data entry and it taxes back 90 million, then the government now has had a deficit that year of, my maths is right, 10 million. So who's got the 10 million? Well, us, the private sector. So in terms of finance, we, in inverted commas, are not the government. And now he's put that down. So if the government is borrowing more, it's not really borrowing more. What it's really done is it's spent more than it taxes in that time through data entry, and it's just decided to sell us debt, which he calls borrowing. So it isn't actually the... So it creates this image, as you know, that a household, that the government's somehow having to take money from us. It's not borrowing money from that sense. It's already spent it. We've got the money in the form of bank reserves, or the non-government sector has, and it's swapping that for debt and calling it borrowing. So it's describing something entirely wrongly and creating the wrong impression. Now, obviously, it is possible, technically, if the government kept on spending loads and loads and loads more than it was taxing, so then leaving loads of reserves in the system, all right? So we were all really, really rich, and we all started spending money hand over fist, that we could get some sort of inflationary problem. But that's miles away if we're ever going to reach that. So the size of the national debt, which is what the government has totally spent and not taxed back, is not a problem. It's good. It's our net saving. And the other thing about interest rates is...
When you say it's our net saving, you mean the non-government sector's net saving?
Our, the real non-government sector, yeah. Say, you know, that example I gave of a government spending 100 million, taxing back 90, that we have a deficit of 10 in that year. If it did that over a 10-year period, 10 each year, 10, a deficit of 10 for 10 consecutive years, then that would be a total of 100, which would be its national debt, and all that would be owned by the non-government sector, us. That would be our net saving, and that would be a good thing, not a bad thing.
And I'll just dive in here and say, hopefully this will simplify it for some people listening as well. Long-time listeners will have already heard me say this many times, but when the UK government sells UK government bonds, they're called gilts, just to confuse everything. they've got all these different names in different countries, but they're called gilts in this country. It's a government bond. When the UK government sells a bond, the purchaser of the bond gives up pounds in return for interest-bearing pounds. So the government are really just swapping normal, boring, non-interest-bearing pounds for interest-bearing pounds. Of course, it has a consequence, but that's all it's doing. It's an asset swap.
Yeah. I believe I read somewhere many years ago, Christian, that the reason it's called gilt without the U is originally there was some sort of gold edging around it on the bit of paper. Maybe, maybe not. It's a nice story. But essentially, it's gilt edged in the sense that it's edged with gold, in the sense that the government won't default because it's got the spreadsheet. Since the government's got the spreadsheet, it can't default, and it will always repay. And it does so just by data entry. So I think, as Warren says, when you just exchange one type of pound from another, like a current account to a savings account. When you've got a bond, you've got your money, or whoever owns the bond, is like a savings account of the central bank.
Yeah.
And then when the bond matures, they click a button and it moves effectively into your current account, or as the Americans say, checking account. And that's all that happens. The debt repayment is just simply a movement of one form of money, as you say, asset swap, to another. And selling of these bonds is now a voluntary operation. Years ago, many years ago, it was operation required to prevent people taking their gold out, their money out in gold, because obviously if you had money which was convertible into gold, the government would want to try and persuade you not to convert your money into gold. So in order to do that, they would offer you a bond or a gilt-edged security with an interest rate and say, don't change it to gold. Have this bond instead, which you can't convert into gold, but we give you some interest for it. We don't need to do that now because the money is not converted into gold. So it's just part of what's accepted as like a voluntary constraint on the system. So we don't need to worry about the size of government borrowing. The only time we'd need to worry is if we saw inflation going up through excess demand. I'm not talking about cost inflation, and we haven't got anything like that at the moment. In fact, we've got unemployment. So the deficit and the national debt, which is the accumulation of that, is too low, not too high. So that's wrong. And I think on the second point about interest rates, well, since the government issues the money, it's a monopoly, and therefore it can set the interest rate at whatever rate it likes. And currently what the government or the central bank, which operates very closely with it, as your listeners will know, they decide at the central bank to set the overnight rate, and they allow in the bond markets, the traders and the so-called primary dealers who buy bonds to set the long-term rate. But this is a choice. If the Bank of England wanted to, it could agree to buy unlimited amounts of bonds and set the interest rate across the yield curve at zero. It chooses not to, but that's its choice, you know. So interest rates would only go up if the Bank of England decided they were going to. So the idea of saying we have to be worried about it, well, it's in your choice.
Yeah, absolutely. And in fact, that what you're talking about is, I believe, yield curve control, as they call it in Japan, right? That's what the Bank of Japan have been doing for three decades. So we know it can be done.
Yeah. It's kind of like putting a big, massive, I don't know, brick behind your door yourself and then saying, I'm really worried about not being able to get out of the house. Well, yeah, it's you that put the brick there. Now, that effectively is what Rishi's saying. We've decided to let markets or bond traders set the yield curve, and we're worried about the fact that the interest rate might go up, even though we actually let them do it and we could stop them doing it at any point in time. So effectively, we go out the back door and take the brick away.
If there isn't a 30-year bond, if they don't issue any, there isn't a yield curve.
You got it, yeah. Don't bother issuing. Yeah, yeah, sure.
I thought about the one of the things that really bothers me about these budgets is that if you notice, whenever they announce a new policy, they always quote the billions of pounds that are going to go into the different things that they're doing.
Yeah, there's no frame of reference there, is there? There's no contextualizing information there. So, and obviously when you say billion or trillion these days, I mean, when you say million, it's a bit run of the mill now, isn't it? You know, because, you know, house prices are different to what they were in the 70s now. So people are like, oh, it's just a small flat in London is a million, right? You know, whereas, you know, when you start saying billions and trillions, people are like, I know that's a big number, but then you put it in context, they don't say over how many years that spending's, you know, basically they do everything except say what the outcome of that spending is going to be. You know, they say what impact it might have on the deficit, or how much of it is going to be from taxation and how much of it is going to be from gilt sales, but they don't say, okay, here's what we're actually going to do.
And in one of the particular contexts that it became quite important is that they announced I think it was 4.5 or 4.8 billion additional funding for local authorities. And as you know, over the last decade or so that the Conservatives have been in power, they've done everything in their power to defund the local authorities.
Yeah.
So they saw this as patting themselves in the back and saying, oh, this is more than we've ever given. Well, it's not hard.
Yes, it is because it's more than zero.
But the other thing to note is that this policy of giving more funding to local authorities comes in at the same time that the Tories have effectively burdened local authorities with the new policy on social care. Whereas the local authorities now have to cover the cost of care of their constituents beyond a certain threshold. I don't know the exact figure because I don't have it in front of me, but this is expected to be actually a few times the cost of the 4.5 billion that they've offered them in funding. So the net effect of the combined policies is still a systemic defunding of the local authorities' services. You put a financial burden on them so large that they have to, by necessity, start defunding the public services that they have or increase taxation on local level. And we know that those areas that need the most public services are the ones that have the least capacity to produce high taxation revenues at local level. So very deceiving just to say figures without any context, you know.
I mean, if I was like dreaming a bit, it would be nice, wouldn't it? If instead of, as you point out, talking only about money, which people can't connect to, you know, or they haven't got a frame of reference. If the government talked about real resources and said, this is what we want to do, and if the real resources are free and available, then they can do that. You know, so if we had, I don't know, 20,000 people who could be nurses at this moment in time, the government could employ them at pretty much zero real costs. I mean, all right, might have to provide them with a few uniforms and a bit of training just to catch them up. But if they're already trained, they're all ready to go, that's what they need to do. So that's about using the monetary system to provision the state and think about what they want to do. So if they say, well, we want to reduce fossil fuels. We're going to put a large tax on carbon, not because we're going to raise money for it. I mean, you could argue that the best revenue of a carbon tax would be naught, because if it's so high that no one uses carbon, you wouldn't make any revenue, and that'd be good. Fully success. It's not about revenue. It's about the effect of the pattern of resource use. So if the resources are there, ready to go, that's what the budget should be about. If, on the other hand, you've got the real resources, but there may be some time lag, that would be another issue. So they may say, look, we've got 20,000 people who could be nurses, but they're not trained. So we need to spend the money to draw those people and train them. And we're explaining how we're going to bridge the gap until they're ready. And that's how the budget will be framed. And there are other things, of course, that, you know, maybe my daughter doesn't like flying. So maybe they might say, oh, well, we're going to have a teleportation device and we're going to pay for that. Well, technology says, sadly, we can't do that. So that's what the government is limited by. It's limited by technology and resources, and that's how the budget should be framed. And obviously, if we were at full employment, if everyone's working flat out, then yeah, we might need to raise taxes so that if you like, people now have got less money to spend on what they were previously spending, so they won't be spending as much on whatever they were buying before, whatever that might be. And that obviously means that the resources that were used previously are now free, and the government can then provision itself with those resources. Like you said in the introduction, using the tax to create unemployment. And if the governments create the unemployment deliberately, like in my case by raising taxes, surely it would employ those people to do what it wants. And that's really what the budget should be about. It should be about setting a vision for how you want to use your real resources to protect the environment or to train people for the health service. Or you may decide as well, you want to do things for ethical reasons. So you want to say, right, we're going to close tax loopholes. I'm not saying the Tory party would ever do that. But you don't need rich people's money. You've got the spreadsheet, you know. I mean, it'd be quite funny. I might try this when I go back to teach engineering. Imagine my first lesson back. I say to the students at the beginning of the lesson, well, I'm a bit worried about marking this register, but I know the guy in the room next to me, he's a really greedy bloke and he's got a massive laptop. In fact, he's got two laptops. So I'm going to go and borrow some. In fact, I'm going to steal from him some present marks to make sure I can mark you all present, because I'm running short. Now, the students might think, I think this guy ought to be retiring. So obviously, many have said that, obviously the government doesn't need rich people's money, but it might decide to tax them for the reason of equity. Does it really want very rich people who use that money to buy maybe environmentally damaging products? Is it bad for the social cohesion of society to have very rich people? Yes, so you may do that. But when I see things from people on the left who should know better, you know, like Richard Bergen, nice guy, or John Trickett, nice guy, talking about taxing the rich to raise money, you can imagine that I've got my head in my hands, like most MMTers, because it's playing the wrong game, you know? We don't need rich people's money.
It's hard, isn't it? Because not to say I turn a blind eye to it, but I deprioritize, you know, getting up in people's faces when they say tax the rich. Mm. You know, MMTers do say tax the rich. You know,
yeah.
We just don't agree with the, you know, the idea is we're taxing the rich, as you say, for social equity purposes. Mm. I mean, I retweeted an MP's proposal yesterday, a Labour MP's proposal, and it was all really right on. And one of the proposals was tax the rich. Mm. Didn't say tax the rich to fund X, Y, and Z or anything like that. Just said tax the rich or tax the ultra rich or raise taxes on the ultra rich. They're not paying enough tax in the eyes of this MP. And I thought, yeah, that's fair enough. And I thought, well, I'll retweet that. But, you know, I had some MMT pals quite rightly going, well, you shouldn't tie taxing the rich to being able to fund programs we can get more buy-in if we don't go on about taxing the rich. I didn't respond to it because, but I just think, well, the person just said tax the rich. I mean, I think we agree with that. Do you know what I mean? I think the person who kind of disagreed with it, or, you know, kind of in their own head added the taxes don't fund spending, blah, blah, blah. It's like, no, this MP didn't say that. I think people have got a bit of an itchy trigger finger when it comes to that now. But anyway, I'm digressing.
I think you're right. My first response when I see tax the rich to fund is I'll always say, and I think you're right, I really agree with the sentiments. But as an aside, we tax the rich for equity rather than revenue. And the reason I would say, the one, I want to show some agreement for the sentiment. And secondly, if you say you're taxing the rich to pay for something, it empowers the rich. It gives them the sense that they need us, they need our money. And then somebody say, yeah, but if you tax the rich, they'll all leave the country, and what you're going to do, because they'll leave their money. And you get, it's like, oh, what a tangled web we weave when once you practice to deceive. Because, oh, well, you're taxing success, the brain drain. So in a way, you've got to politely, yeah, I love the sentiments. Politicians are slightly different, because my first response to politicians is the same thing. But I do get frustrated because I don't think politicians seem to read their replies, and they keep on saying the same thing. Well, to me, Twitter's a dialogue. There's no point, you know, whether you agree with it or not, you have to listen to what people say. And I think that the left are making a massive mistake by, they're essentially trying to play the Tories at their own game with this sort of handbag economics, you know, with fiscal rules. So all they're really saying is, we're going to tax the rich to pay for the poor, like a Robin Hood. But as I said, you just open yourself up to all these other criticisms and all these empowerments of the rich that are unnecessary if you just, I'm a simple soul, tell the truth. You know, tell it as it is, politely. Don't upset your friends, you know. And I agree with you, Christian, being polite to people and tell them, you know, you agree with the sentiments. It's a good idea to tax the rich, but it's nothing to do with revenue. Mm.
I do think, and I'm sorry now, because I think that a lot of our lefty audience might have a bit of an issue with what I'm about to say. Hopefully not. But I do feel that sometimes, you know, the lefty politicians, the ones that are at the forefront that we all put our hopes up for in politics, at least in the UK, I don't really see much of a strategy from them in terms of political strategy or really understanding what the game is about.
Yeah, yeah.
Instead, you know, we see them repeat these phrases over and over because they're basically repeating the line that they've held for decades and decades. And hoping that this time it'll be different and people will suddenly listen. And if they just repeat the same message over and over, people will get behind it.
Yeah, yeah.
It's frustrating because we can plainly see not working. We know how the script goes. The Tories say, oh, there is no money for this. And it's like, there is if you tax the rich. Oh, and then it falls. Oh, we can't tax the rich because then we'll leave and then we'll really not have money. Mm-hmm. We know how the script goes and we see it played over and over and over. And yet they still go for the same line of attack and they still fall for the same tricks.
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe they feel they have to, and deep inside they're like, oh yeah, I'm completely on board with MMT. I just say this because I feel I have to. Or if they genuinely still believe that things work that way.
My feeling is that they don't actually know. I have done one or two interviews with politicians. I don't get any feeling that they understand the system at all. And I think, particularly with the left, their narrative plays out to their audience. You know, the rich are the bad guys. They've got a lot of money by exploiting you. Yeah, and we're going to take their money because they've got it in an ill-gotten way and we're going to spend it on things. And there's a sort of righteous indignation about it that their audience that believe them buys into it. And I have some sympathy for that because I'm a socialist myself and I get that. But the problem is that ordinary people, inverted commas, will think, well, I don't really understand how that's going to work because aren't these rich people all the kind of guys that generate the wealth? That's how they think. And if we confiscate, inverted commas, that's the type of method, their income, then won't they all leave the country, and then there won't be any money to get from the following year, and then we'll be even poorer. And so, in a way, as you say, the argument just repeats itself, going round and round in circles. And the only way you can break out of that is just by telling the truth, that we don't need the rich people's money. If we've got spare resources, we can use them in the way we want, with or without the rich. Forget about them. And then if we decide we want to tax the rich in particular ways for equity reasons, or maybe because we don't have enough money to go and destroy the environment in space rockets, well, that's a separate thing, you know what I mean? But the two things are different to each other. And I think if you could do that, it would be great. But I have, like you, almost no sense of optimism that any politician really understands that or would be willing to separate the two out in that way. I wish I could be more optimistic about it. I like to be an optimist, but I just don't see it, you know? I haven't seen it in any politician.
You know, MMT has made inroads. I always think if it can break through in a really significant way, like it did in the States with, say, Representative John Yarmouth, in the US, they're very government phobic. I've got sympathy with that point of view as well, you know, just because something's government run doesn't necessarily mean it's going to be accountable. And, you know, I think the debate should be about what's the best mechanism to create accountability. I think I'm channeling John Harvey when I say this, you know, let's let the market decide. And some things are kind of, you know, probably natural monopolies, and it's not practical or effective to, you know, it's actually impossible to create a market mechanism that's going to deliver accountability and responsiveness to the users of that good or service. And so I think really what we want to do is give people the lens to see that, you know, so that they can decide for themselves, yeah, this should be market determined. And this other thing, you know, for me, healthcare, I think markets can't possibly deliver dignified and world-class healthcare, I don't think, you know. That's just me. That's not MMT. You know, that's just me using the MMT lens and thinking, well, if you think something's a human right, you really just have to guarantee it, right? You can't create a market for human rights, I don't think. I don't think it works.
Did any of you two listen to the response to the budget by Rachel Reeves?
Yeah. It's kind of what Phil was saying. Like, they don't seem to have a plan. I thought it was pretty weak. One thing that stood out to me is she did say, national insurance is a regressive tax, which I thought that's pretty bang on the money, as it were.
Yeah, I don't want to be too harsh on her. She said some things that were quite effective and were actually very snappy ways of highlighting, you know, the whole Rishi Sunak feel of the budget and this idea that people are paying more and receiving very little. And he's raising taxes and our public services are in the worst state ever. And that's true.
Maybe I was looking at it with the wrong perspective, you know, because I just very much like, if you're just going to use their macroeconomic framework, government like a household, saving for bad times, all that kind of stuff, which literally came up in his speech, then yeah, you're going to have a hard time knocking down his... I want to see their talking points knocked down by knocking down the framing. And obviously that doesn't happen. So I am going to be disappointed by whatever transpires.
Yeah, she was never going to speak MMT, was she? But at least at the beginning, she did point out something, you know, because Rishi Sunak was saying, oh, we're growing 5% this year, you know, amazing. But obviously we just came back from a GDP drop of 20%. You know? So,
yeah.
But, you know, we're still below pre-COVID. So it's nothing really to brag about. And she was really good at bringing attention to his manipulation of those figures, I thought. Where she failed was in the following line, which she could have made GDP about standards of living and about, you know, how people's lives were getting harder and harder. She then said, and everybody knows that in order to pay the debt, you need to grow the economy. I just like, oh, you were doing so well.
Yeah.
Yeah, she didn't need to bring it back to the fiscal budget thing. She could have just talked about outcomes, you know.
Basically, he talked about how well the economy was doing, better than the Office of Budget Responsibility predicted, the OBR. So then he goes on to say, so we need to strengthen our public finances so that when the next crisis comes, we've got the fiscal space to act.
And I'm pulling my hairs off at this stage.
Oh. Coronavirus just proved, you know, you didn't need savings from a rainy day fund to do crisis spending. You know, there's no such thing. Governments don't save in their own currency. Governments that issue their currency don't borrow it, you know, in any meaningful sense of the word. And they can't save it. You know, they can tax more than they spend, but, you know, they can run a surplus, but they don't get anything. They're removing aggregate demand from the economy.
It's sometimes, I think, with these budget responses, I mean, I didn't hear Rachel. I just had a quick, you know, I've had a quick look at it on the news summary, but I didn't hear it live. I think one of the things the Tories are really bad at, economic management, even if you took the handbag model. So if we try and imagine for a moment that the government was a currency user and it was actually getting taxes and or borrowing to fund spending, even in those erroneous terms, it's really bad. So in a sense, it'd be quite easy, wouldn't it, to criticise them by saying, look, you've cut taxes on the rich, you know, you've made the poor poorer and the rich richer, you've got, you know, you've let all our privatised water companies put sewage into rivers, you've cut the support for people on universal credit. So in their own terms, they're really bad. So any Labour chancellor, even if they do not understand monetary operations, which Rachel Reeves doesn't, it's almost too easy. To use an analogy, I guess it's like, say, you were a pre-Copernican astronomer and one of the astronomers you were with was really bad. I mean, you both thought the Earth was the middle of the solar system, but one of you has got like a mucky telescope that's pointing in the wrong direction. And then the other guy at least has got the telescope clean and pointing the right way. I mean, they're both using the wrong model. But I mean, so the Tories are bad even on their own terms. The question really is, like Christy was saying, when will, if ever, an opposition responder, if you like, take them on systemic matters?
Even the life expectancy issue as well. You could have dragged them through the floor with that.
Yeah, I mean, pretty much everything they could have got wrong, they've got wrong. You know, not making light of it. I mean, the death rates for COVID, the whole handling of COVID has been absolutely reprehensible. You know, the Prime Minister disappearing when he should be there.
You know, these things, to me, it seems like the government, they'll go, oh, you know, COVID really knocked the nation back because, you know, the NHS was at breaking point and then COVID came along and, you know, the government's got its hands full and they're having a really hard time. And it's like, the NHS was at breaking point because of the government, because of a decade of underfunding and defunding. And
she did allude to that, but didn't make it too clear, I think.
What I'm saying is, to me, the press generally treat Boris Johnson and Rishi Sunak in their individual contexts as they're like goalies in a penalty shootout. You know, they're like, yeah, come on, nobody expects you to do well. So, you know what I mean? If you manage to bat one away, you're a legend. do you know what I mean?
I like that. Yeah.
They just get a really easy ride of it. And it's like, well, they put themselves in this situation to start with. They haven't been dealt a bad hand and they're doing their best and they dealt themselves a bad hand and they're not doing their best. So Rishi Sunak comes on and he goes, good news, the economy's growing faster than the Office of Budget Responsibility forecast, so we can spend more than we thought, you know, because the reality is they can actually spend whatever they vote to spend. They have to sort of come up with some constraint. Here's something from Sky News. This is a quote. Quote, the Chancellor today has delivered a, quote, Boris budget, unquote, by spending half of the large $141 billion borrowing windfall that was handed down by the Office for Budget Responsibility, observes Thorsten Bell of the Resolution Foundation think tank. Now, maybe I'm going to ask this to you, Phil. How does that work? How do they think that works? The Office of Budget Responsibility has handed down some funds to the Chancellor. I mean, do you know what I mean? It's like, that's not where the money comes from. I mean, that's the kind of commentary, that's the level of commentary we've got.
Maybe. I mean, I don't know. It's all such doublespeak. I mean, I haven't read the article. It's quite possible the Office of Budget Responsibility has guessed how much they would quote-unquote borrow, i.e. they've actually got better tax revenues than they thought, so the deficit was a bit lower. So that means, oh, well, now we've got more permission to spend more. But obviously, it's all described in a back-to-front way, as you point out, that it doesn't make any sense, because if tax revenues are higher than predicted, meaning the deficit is lower than predicted, that means that the private sector, us, the non-government sector, is actually poorer than predicted, ceteris paribus. So we're all meant to be happy about that. And it doesn't possibly give the government any more room to spend. They've still got exactly the same number of keys on the spreadsheet. But as you say, if you can make up an organisation, the opposite of budget responsibility, that is giving you some sort of expectation of what your borrowing might be, and if it looks as though your borrowing's a bit less than that, they're metaphorically patting you on the back and go, well, you can borrow that extra bit anyway for being good. So you've eaten your greens, so you can have an extra ice cream.
I think we ought to just dive in and talk about the Office of Budget Responsibility, and if any of you guys have got anything to say about it. But I'll just set the table by saying, this is from Wikipedia, the Office of Budget Responsibility is a non-departmental public body funded by the UK Treasury that the UK government established to provide independent economic forecasts and independent analysis
right.
of the public finances. It was created in May 2010, following that general election. That wonderful general election that gave us the coalition.
You mean it was funded at the time when the government thought responsibility of budget was the priority?
Yeah.
But it's independent and has nothing to do with the... Okay.
Exactly.
It's got a great name, hasn't it, don't you think?
It sounds very responsible.
It does. It sounds, and that responsible thing. And I don't know if it tells you on Wikipedia what their forecasting record is like. I mean, I could be wrong.
Yeah.
But my thing is that say that you or I made a forecast. Say I said to you, you know, I support Middlesbrough, and I think if everything goes well, they might finish seventh. Let's say we're a couple of games before the end of the season and they're lining 18th. I couldn't really then say to you, I'm revising down my forecast, could I? Because you'd say, well, see, I know that now, but you told me being sufficient. Now, that's effectively what all these organisations do. You know, the IMF, they all have these models, none of which work. And they all kind of pan out forecasts, and they're very precise in as much as they often give you like their forecast to two places of decimals to give the illusion of precision. But they're always wrong. And as Keynes reputedly said, it's better to be roughly right than precisely wrong. But they're always wrong. But just before it's proved that they are wrong, watch out for this phrase. Everybody out there listening, revising down. And whenever you hear that, you think about me saying Borough are going to finish seventh and changing my mind a couple of games before the end of the season. They always get it wrong, all right, because none of the models work. Well, they might get it right through once, like out of chance, you know, once every decade, you know. If you stopped a kid in the street and said, ask them for a guess a figure, they might get it right. So, I mean, it's just a bit of a joke, really, to be honest. I mean.
Yeah.
But on a serious note, I might point out, wouldn't Parliament be the Office of Budget Responsibility? But I'm going back to the real resources, which is what it shouldn't elected. I'm being serious for a moment. But if we think about it, shouldn't Parliament, our elected representatives, think about the best way that their spending should deploy our real resources here in the UK? They should be responsible. You know, if we need more health service workers, they should be the ones providing the money to employ them. And if we feel that we're, you know, using too much carbon, they should be the ones that are bringing in the legislation to reduce our use of it. So that's where the responsibility lies. It lies in real resource use. It lies in what's happened to our environment, whether our children are getting education, whether our you know, young people are able to find fruitful jobs, what our health is like, mental and physical. This is responsibility. You know, where it's not all about playing around with, it's all smoke and mirrors. And the thing that is irony, as I said, they get it wrong anyway. So even if it was of value, which it not, it doesn't work.
Yeah, I think the game is for government to try and create these avenues for plausible deniability.
Yeah.
So the idea is, you know, oh, we've got the Bank of England, you know, we delegate all the economy stuff to the Bank of England. Mm. It's their job to take away the punch bowl, mm-hmm. which they never do. You know, like I said at the beginning, government checks don't bounce. The Bank of England don't get to veto an item they don't like in the budget. But the idea is, yeah, you know, if there is higher unemployment than we'd like, the clever people at the Bank of England have this thing called the natural rate of unemployment, and it's not zero, unfortunately. So some people are just going to have to be unemployed, but that's the way it has to work with money, I'm afraid. And, you know, we've delegated it to them. You know, if we actually got involved, that would be being political. You know, if we were actually to state a policy, that would be being political. So, we're, you know, the unemployment that we've got at the moment, that's apolitical unemployment. You know, with the demise of monetarism and people understanding actually moving interest rates by tiny amounts isn't a great way to optimize the economy. It doesn't deliver, you know, it is like trying to push on a string. It's just not an effective tool. And then we can turn to the Office of Budget Responsibility for their plausible deniability. Well, we can't because the OBR says we'll run out of money. And to your point, Phil, that you said, you know, what's their predictive power like? Well, obviously, you know, Rishi has managed to spin this into, aren't I great? But they didn't, you know, obviously they didn't get the prediction right because the economy's growing faster than the OBR forecast. So, you know, obviously they didn't get it right. So, yeah, you're probably right. And in fact, the whole thing is dripping in politics and ideology, isn't it? You know, it's the easiest thing in the world to give a cloudy forecast and then have the Chancellor come along and go, oh, you see, it wasn't all doom and gloom. Didn't I do well?
Yeah. Well, they can't lose in a way, because if the OBR says that the forecast is a certain level and the economy grows faster, they can take the credit for it and say we've done better than they thought we would do. If they do worse than that, they could say, well, that's because of unforeseen circumstances, or what was the other one? Uncertainty in the world economy. That's a very popular one. Things we didn't see on the horizon, very sadly, which has meant that we haven't quite made the forecast. But nevertheless, we've battled bravely through. So whatever happens, they've never made a mistake, have they? You know, they're always covered. Yeah, you know, it's like, you know, if you go on those phone lines, you know, where you have to wait for a call. They always say, don't they, that they're having higher than expected call volumes. I mean, I wonder if any of the listeners have ever heard them say, don't worry, today we've got lower than expected call volumes. We've got plenty of staff, so don't worry about it. It never happens. So, you know what I mean? They're covered whatever they do. And like you say, they just got fall guys that take the hit, and they can use their forecasting whatever way. And if they did happen to get it right, they would say, look, we put the right men in charge because they know what they're doing. So whatever happens, fabulous. It's laughable. And the idea that a parliament doesn't want to get involved in dealing with things because they are quote unquote political, well, isn't that what they're supposed to be doing? You know, if you go to hospital, it's like the surgeon coming in and giving the scalpel to the woman behind the desk. You know, it's like, well, I don't want to get involved in any surgery, you know.
I don't want to get involved in, that would make this whole thing medical. I don't want to get involved in anything medical. Yeah.
You can't medicalize the surgery. Come on.
Yeah, that would be terrible. I know you've elected us to run the country and make sure real resources are deployed correctly. That's dangerously political. I mean, I just want to go in the bar and have a drink of wine free. No.
You've elected us to, you've employed us to enact policy. It just sounds a bit political to me.
Yeah. This sounds like a line from, you know, one of the, from Yes Minister. But you can imagine how they're insulating themselves from having to take any sort of major political decision to do with the economy. So then give them all to someone else. It's a cracking idea, you know?
Yeah. So back to this idea that they believe that the government can save for a rainy day. So the chance of which is impossible, you know, when you understand monetary operations, that's not what happens. And so the Chancellor laid out new fiscal rules today. So I'm going to quote from Reuters, the latest iteration of Britain's fiscal rules with an aim to reduce public sector debt while ensuring the government borrows only for investment. So this is the rule. This is one rule. Underlying public sector net debt, excluding the impact of the Bank of England, must, as a percentage of GDP, be falling. I guess, what, at all times? I mean, you know, what do you think to that?
Well, I mean, it's hard to describe it other than like crazy lunacy, because, I mean, the technical term that, I mean, Patricia will have come across this in her studies, I'm sure, and I'm sure you've heard this word many times, endogenous, Christian.
Yeah.
That the government cannot control its own income. So therefore, it spends money and it gets taxes back. And depending on the level of economic activity, that determines its deficit. And that's a good thing because it's an automatic stabilizer. So what you're really doing is trying to say that we're going to push against the automatic stabilizers a little bit like a dog chasing its tail. So let's say we went into a depression or recession of some sort, tax revenues crash. So the government then automatically has to pay out more welfare payments. It'll try not to, but it automatically has to, and its tax revenues crash, so its deficit gets bigger. And that's good because it supports the economy. Then they'll go, no, the deficit's breaking our fiscal rules, so we'll have to reduce our discretionary spending, commonly called austerity. And when they do that, of course, that means that a lot of the money they were spending in the economy now goes down, so the economy gets even smaller, so it gets even worse.
Public health, public education, yeah, all that stuff goes on the chopping block, yeah.
And then it keeps on getting worse and worse and worse until they realise that they're all going to lose the election. So then they say we were wrong about the rules and say austerity doesn't work anymore, which is kind of what happened last time. So they just won't use the word austerity. So I think the Tories are now, you were talking about the Office of Budget Responsibility. They'll probably be chewing their pens somewhere trying to think of a word that means austerity but isn't called austerity. And I'm going to say rebalancing's been used before. So we could guess their word. We could have a go. What are they going to call the new austerity where they're worried about their rule bill broken, so they've got to find a way of cutting spending in a mistaken attempt to try to keep within the rule.
The fiscal rule gives them the excuse they need to cut spending in future.
Yes.
And usually when you instigate a rule like that, the people whose shoulders it falls on tend to be the least represented, the weakest in society. So yes. I have no doubt that this rule at some point will be weaponized against, you know, welfare recipients, will be weaponized against public sector workers. And what annoys me about it was Labour who gave them this idea.
Yes.
God's sake. And Labour, of course, now can't criticise it because it was their idea.
Yeah.
It's kind of mirrored by, you know, how people talked about, you know, Obamacare in the States. It was like, this is Romney care.
Yeah.
Actually, you know, it's mirrored, I think. But so the second fiscal rule: in normal times, the state should only borrow to invest in our future growth and prosperity. And the rules apply over a 3-year horizon. And Sunak added that the government's already met the rules under the judgment of the OBR. You know, again, another little pat on the back.
That's funny, isn't it?
Bill was really good at criticizing the original rule. And one of the things was that the kind of the line defining what constitutes spending and what constitutes investment is far more hazy than people realize it is. Mm. So, for example, at the moment, I believe that teachers' wages constitute day-to-day spending. But of course, education, you can consider that as an investment.
Yes.
Yeah, it's not simple. And there is room in there for manipulation, depending on what political outcome you want.
Yes.
And the other thing is, it's more of a question, actually, for you, Phil. Perhaps you can clarify this for me. But how can they tell what is coming out of a deficit and what isn't coming out of a deficit? Like, we can't tell. As far as I know, we can't tell, can we?
You mean like what?
Like, what kind of spending is being funded in what way?
I mean, what they can do, and Keynes talked a bit about this a long time ago. What you can do in all this is kind of construct synthetic funds. They're just accounting conventions, you know, like, so you might say, like, the money we collect in tax from X, for accounting purposes, we're going to count as funding for Y, you know? But it's all, if you like, imaginary. And it may give you some form of internal budgetary discipline, but it's all made up. So in answer to your question...
So there is more room to for manipulation then?
Yeah, and like you say, you could... I mean, this idea, you could argue that all public spending is really investment, couldn't you be said? Because if you're cleaning the roads and you're paying teachers well, then that means that this young people will be educated for the future. So therefore, you could, I mean, I'm playing a little bit of devil's advocate, but you could categorize all public spending as investment if you wanted to, and therefore get off the hook, couldn't you, with, you know, the current spending has to be balanced, but you can borrow for investment, if you see what I mean. Keynes did this when is the fancy term he used, bifurcate the budget. And he had this idea of a current budget which would be in balance or in small surplus, but you would get full employment by, if you like, unbalancing the capital account. But he never called that a deficit. He called that making sure that you were investing sufficiently to maintain full employment. And it was planned. Now, what his critics accused him of trying to actually disguise deficit spending in other ways, but he was quite a shrewd operator, as you know. Now, obviously, that idea got a little bit like Chinese whispers. A lot of people assumed that Keynes was saying that, you know, like this squirreling away nuts for the winter, you know, this thing like saving money from like in a boom, to make you've got more money to spend when you're in a recession. But that's not in Keynes. It doesn't appear anywhere that I've read. And I've read quite a lot of his original writing. I can't find anything. That's like sort of some sort of later edition. So the whole idea of we're going to get money and do something else with it, you know, use it in some purpose, it's just a synthetic fund structure somewhere. I don't really see there's any validity in that. I think the only way they tend to think about it, like when I've met politicians, they have like a general, those that will say that the government's not like a household, they will say, well, if the debt gets too big, inverted commas, they can't define what that means, but they think that if the debt gets too big, then it will be more expensive or more difficult for the government to borrow, so interest rates will go up. So although the government isn't like a household, so they might reject the Thatcherite thing, they still want to maintain debt levels at a low level, you know, because it frightens markets and all that type of stuff. And I think John McDonnell's Labour got trapped with that, with their fiscal rules, which were a ridiculous idea. I know Bill Mitchell took them apart regularly. Stupid.
Yeah.
Speaking of John, there's breaking news.
Right, wow.
John McDonnell has just tweeted, and perhaps you can help me interpret this tweet. He said, as we examine a Red Book setting out the detail of Sunak's budget, it's become increasingly clear Sunak has thrown local councils under a bus in this budget. Council tax increases of over £400 a household are built into Sunak's budget. So what has he done?
I think the implication is that I don't know, but he's expecting councils to have to increase their spending because of the requirements that he's, I guess, projecting councils are going to have to spend. then he's working out what Rishi's given them and then come up with that figure as the gap between what he thinks councils are going to have to spend and what Rishi's actually providing them with. But I don't know. That's the only interpretation I can give as to where he's got that figure from.
Or more likely for £100 less spending per household as opposed to increased taxation.
Could be, yeah.
So, you know, I think an overall theme of the budget is we're giving back. You know, we're lowering taxes on this. We're injecting money into the economy on that. But it's like, you know, you're just increasing spending on things whose spending you absolutely reduced to zero over the last decade or so. Do you know what I mean? So, you know, they've been underfunding councils like since 2010 and, you know, and vowing to basically cut government grants to councils down from 80% to 70%. Or, you know, and their pledge was to get it, you know, down to zero, I think, at one point. You know, and obviously things have fallen apart and, you know, regions have fallen into, you know, more hardship.
Yeah.
And so they're going, okay, I guess we're just going to have to write the check on this one.
Yeah.
Giving out a few crumbs and saying we're being the most generous we've ever been.
The Tories are good, in a way, at giving just enough away, aren't they, to prevent the system crashing. You know, like in COVID, they knew they had to provide a furlough, otherwise the system would have crashed and they'd been booted out. So they did what they had to do through gritted teeth. It's like you said, Christian, that they've underfunded local authorities and public services so badly that the base is so low that now they're feeling, well, if we give a bit, we'll look good now relative to how poor we've been. And if we don't, we could be in trouble. I mean, it reminds me when I was at primary school, you know, a lad came from down south, you know, could have been Nottingham, you know, it was well down south from where I lived. Yeah, so from Nottingham, you know, the glittering south, and he lived in Middlesbrough, and he was a real worldly-wise lad. Called him Jimmy. He was a bit of a lad. And he was in my primary school class, and he didn't work very hard early on in the year. And, you know, and I knew he was quite clever because I knew him quite well. So why is your work so bad, Jimmy? And he goes, well, when I meet a new teacher, I never do very well before Christmas. And then afterwards, I do what I can, and she thinks I'm improving. And he always got really good scores. He got, you know, those where you're too young, you used to get little gold stars because he was doing better. And the teacher thought he was, you know, she was making a difference for him. Eh? What a crafty fellow. And that's really what you're saying. You know, they've done that bad. They're improving now, but from a very low base, you know. And they ain't getting any gold stars from me, that's for sure.
Yeah. It's an important and kind of subversive thing to do to remind people what a good economy looks like.
Yeah.
Which is something that, you know, I often share this speech that Warren Mosler gave when he was in Italy in, I think it was 2014. It could have been earlier, talking about MMT because, you know, Italian grassroots organizations were wondering why everything was so bad, you know, and, you know, wanted to know how the money system worked over there. And so, you know, they found Warren's work and probably Randy's work and everything, but Warren went over there and gave this speech, and he started off by saying, you'd have to be at least as old as me to remember what a good economy looks like. And he said, you know, I can remember it. You know, businesses were competing so hard to get workers that they would hire you while you were still at school.
Yeah.
You know, and this was a good economy. It was delivering real outcomes, you know, and I can't remember the speech verbatim, yeah, but it was a great way to open the speech and get people focused on what's important. You know, that it wasn't a particularly lefty take. You know, it's just like, look, this is what it looks like when it's working for everybody, you know, or 99% of people,
yeah,
you know, and this is what it's meant to be. You know, even the proponents of capitalism don't want it to be such a punitive, hard life for everybody. You know, yeah, we want good jobs doing meaningful things and innovation, you know, and we're losing that. We're losing that, the memory of institutions that help deliver that.
Yeah. I think it comes back, doesn't it, to real resources in the sense that are our young people, are we giving them as a society the opportunity to do fruitful, productive, innovative work in the public or private sector? Are they working to their potential? Because at my age, it's the young working population that are producing the goods and services that I need. Are we building an economy that, if we like, lives up to our means? I know that we've said these politicians don't like political decisions. Are they making the decisions in their spending which deploys our real resources in a green way, in an innovative way, in a productive way? Are they creating an environment where the private sector, when they use their resource, isn't as much as a government can? Is it providing the right sort of infrastructure, you know, the right health and safety regulation, the right protection of the environment to allow our private sector to flourish while looking after their workers, etc.? That's really what a budget should be about. It shouldn't be really about, you know, fiddling on with fiscal rules and made up budget responsibility and all these things, and certainly setting rules for getting out of government debt in 3 year cycles when it's impossible anyway. So the whole premise of the budget and the whole budgetary framework is so wrong. You know, it's really, really difficult for somebody like who sees through an MMT lens. It can be very frustrating, you know, because you watch people say this sort of thing, you know, twice a year or whatever, and you just put your head in your hands and go, what are you talking about? You know, what? Let's talk about things that really matter.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, let's move into the home straight. The MMT take in the broad strokes is, we want zero unemployment, zero involuntary unemployment, and we know how to get there. It's called the job guarantee, and it has all these extra benefits, but the chief among them is everybody is entitled to not a living wage, as they put it in all this literature, but a dignified wage, or a socially inclusive wage, as I've heard Bill Mitchell put it, and I like it too, you know, like, and therefore it gets you to have to think about, okay, yeah, what wage does allow you to be included in what we call society, you know, like, in that would be leisure time as well, you know, and not pinching every penny just to buy necessities, but, you know, leisure time and, you know, time to associate with people and, you know, have a cultural life. You know, you can not just set the minimum wage, but enforce the minimum wage through this job guarantee. And in the show notes, I'll link to more in-depth conversations about how the job guarantee works as a macroeconomic stabilizer, as a price anchor. Just the words alone, job guarantee, let you know what it is if you're new here, that the idea is that, you know, anybody willing and able to work gets a socially inclusive wage for doing a full-time week. I mean, you could even define what a full-time week is. You know, if we decide, hey, you know, we should go down from 40 to 35, if now there is a guaranteed job, a 35-hour week job at a socially inclusive wage, the rest of the private sector has to fall in line. And it's basically putting a floor under how far you can sink in the economy. But you'll always sink down to, you know, if you lose your job, you'll always sink down to a job that pays a socially inclusive wage. And, you know, we think that's a good idea. We know the government can afford it because, like I started to say at the top of the show, the government creates new money when it spends. So in terms of affordability, it can spend that money because of the way it spends. But also, we know that it's not bidding for something that the private sector is already bidding for, because the private sector has decided not to give these people in the job guarantee pool a job. So, you know, without the job guarantee, their bid is zero. So we're basically putting a floor under the economy. And this is a real outcome. This is something you would want to see in a budget, I think, that gets away from, we're putting this many billion into the NHS, and we're putting this many billion into building libraries or something like that. And just these completely decontextualized numbers. And, you know, they never say over what time frame or anything like that. So you don't really...
Or what the money is meant to achieve, you know?
Yeah. Exactly. They're not really making a promise that you can hold them to. Whereas if you say, look, nobody is going to be involuntarily unemployed on our watch ever again, that's a real promise. That's what we would like to see. And we believe it's possible. And we've, you know, and the decades of MMT literature, some of it scholarly, some of it written for the lay audience, it's all out there to make the case for this. And as Warren Mosler, the co-founder of MMT, it says, you know, on the technical side, none of this stuff's been substantively refuted.
Sorry for going back a bit, but just on the subject of the OBR forecast, I found an image which I am hoping that we include in the show notes. Yeah. It's about the successive forecasts that the OBR have done for the last 10 years. And every single year they've predicted that productivity and as a result GDP was going to shoot off and go up pretty dramatically. You know, the economy just pretty dramatically recovering and suddenly an age of prosperity is coming. Mm. And every year they've had to revise it down. And so and every year they make the same prediction. Every year they say it's going to go up. It's about to happen. It's just around the corner. It's happening. And then it never happens. And productivity has been pretty much a straight line since 2010.
Yeah.
And that takeoff of the economy has not happened. I'm just wondering how long they can carry on doing the same forecast.
Do you think this is a bit like the football supporter? Okay, I'll go back. Say when I was young, I was more optimistic about the Borough, right? For years of bitter disappointment. So I might, at the beginning of the season, every season, you know, you go down, I used to go with my dad and say, right, Dad.
This is the year.
Yeah, this is the year where we're going to win something. Every year I'd say that. So that's my, a bit like the OBR. Every year, this is the year, big spike, growth's going to go for fabulous. And then pretty much every year as we neared the end of the season, I would quote unquote revise down my forecast. Then we have the next season, you know, have a season off, I've read the paper, the Evening Gazette is our local paper, Borough by Brazilian striker. You know, he's only got one leg, but we've heard he's good. So then when we come in, I say to me, Dad, again, this is the year, Dad, and so on. Now, it seems to me what you're saying is the OBR is just like me when I was young. It hasn't really learned that successful season hasn't yet come. You know, like, how old is the OBR?
It started in 2010, so Patricia's pretty much talking about its entire lifespan.
Well, that's fine. It's only 11 years old. And by the age of 11, I was still optimistic. I still thought we were going to win something. So that explains it. When it's 63, then they might get it right. They'll be all miserable and they'll be going, there ain't going to be no growth.
So they do these forecasts twice a year, I believe. So there are 20 of these forecasts. So you're saying that in 120 times after they've made the same forecast consistently every 6 months.
Yeah, they'll finally give up.
They realize maybe our methods are a bit dodgy.
Yeah, maybe we're just a tad optimistic, you know. There was one, it was really, I did this talk at the Green Party, and what I did was I got this Bank of England forecast. You know, they have like a fan chart. It's where the Bank of England try to predict GDP. It's not too dissimilar to that. And they showed what the Bank of England thought would happen. So they did the forecast in 2006. So it was their forecast for the next 5 years from 2006. And it was a nice sort of steady growth of about 3%-ish. And then obviously I showed the real one where the line just fell off the chart because of the financial crisis. So it was all completely, I mean, massive, as wrong as you could get. Then I showed them the forecast at 2011, but their forecast line at that point was the same, more or less the same as they had in 2006. It was just that same line going up at a steady pace. And they have to forecast that, the Bank of England, because if they don't, somebody say, well, what are you doing about it then? So in a way, they have to forecast good because someone will get the sack, won't they? Or they get into trouble. Like when I was a teacher, if I went and sat in front of the head and said, all the kids are going to fail, he would say to me, well, what are you going to do about it then? So in a way, they're trapped, aren't they, into this world of optimism.
Yeah, yeah.
Because I guess, although it's supposed to be quote-unquote independent, if they started forecasting gloom, I think the men in grey suits, wouldn't they, would go and take away their pensions and their nice big salaries.
Yeah.
So I could be wrong, but I think if we meet again in a year, I think they'll have made another rosy forecast, and I hope I'm wrong. But I think they will be wrong about it, but we'll see.
Yeah. I guess the overarching theme of the budget then, I would say, is they realize that they're going to have to do something to at least look as if they're trying to put the economy back on its feet. So it's announcing we're increasing spending here, here and here. You know, for instance, £300 million going into a Start for Life parenting programs, and an extra $170 million going into paying for childcare by 2024, 2025. And, you know, just as a small example, this is after they closed all the Sure Starts down, you know, from 2010 and just took loads and loads of social spending away. So, and because the way they throw these figures out there, we don't know what effect that's going to have. The $300 million, the $170 million. We don't know whether we're going to get back to the world that was there before they started dismantling it by defunding it. So it's the only kind of budget we get with this framework, which is a kind of smoke and mirrors, maybe this will work, maybe it won't, type of a document of intent. And yeah, we just get back on with our lives and hope it's all going to work out, you know, when they're, you know, lowering taxes on polluting activities like short haul flights and stuff. You know, it's not a rosy picture. And in a way, it's not really a picture. It's a bunch of numbers, and we don't really know what the outcome of this bunch of numbers is going to be.
No.
But one thing's for certain, the fiscal rule will lock in austerity in a downturn.
Yeah.
Or they'll have to break the rule. You know, that's a real thing.
Yeah.
The national living wage going up by a few pence, that's a real thing. National living wage going up can't be bad, but it can't go up high enough for me, really, I think. You know, I think they could have afforded to go higher. Yeah, you know, those are my lasting thoughts about it.
Yeah, I would say it's framed totally wrongly. So the whole structure is set against is completely wrong. So the canvas on which it's painted is wrong. And even in its own terms, it's totally inadequate and a typical Tory face-saving budget where they're trying to save the skins. And I can't honestly find anything of merit in it. I mean, there's probably little tiny bits of things that aren't too bad for a Tory budget, but it's pretty poor. It's just tinkering around the edges, you know, instead of doing something that might be in any way transformative. So I guess it's more or less what you might expect from a Tory government. I'm straying very slightly into politics, but I hope that didn't come across at all.
Politicians saying things about where they're going to spend and where they're going to cut. Guess what? It's political, isn't it?
Yeah, it has to be. Yeah. Thomas Carlyle, the commentator in the 19th century, described economics as the dismal science. And I think when you've got the Tories in charge, the budget is a dismal day, isn't it? Because any sort of glimmer of expectation of something good is always a triumph of hope over experience, I think. But we'll battle on. You know, you guys are doing a great job, you know, and I hope we've made a few little amusing stories to cheer up the listeners in amongst the picture of incompetence we've painted about the Chancellor and its modelling skills.
Not to go out on a bad note, but I am optimistic because, like I say, you know, I look at what's happening in the States where, you know, the US culture is kind of quite government phobic, very suspicious of government. But important politicians like John Yarmuth, who's chair of the House Budget Committee, I believe, you know, so it's not like somebody at the fringes there, is fully conversant with MMT now and, you know, is talking a lot of sense and getting listened to. And as Warren said, people don't talk like that in a vacuum. There's got to be people around him as well who get it. So I think if it can break through there, it can break through here. You know, we've had people like Chris Williamson and his movement have Bill Mitchell give talks on a regular basis. It is breaking through. I think it's all about eyes on the prize, not expecting things to just change just because, you know, we wrote a particularly great blog post one day and you know, and somebody read it and went, "Oh, right, I'm just going to change policy now." You know, it doesn't work like that. It is about sometimes you've just got to keep your eyes on the prize and keep spreading the word, I think. And things are changing, but in human years, it can seem a bit glacial for sure.
Yeah, you know, to finish the positive, I know it was a bit negative. It would be great to talk to you guys after an MMT informed budget.
Yeah.
Sometime in the future, where we're talking about whether we agreed with the real resource deployment,
yeah,
and whether the job guarantee was working quite in the way we expected. Wouldn't that be good?
Even if we didn't agree on everything.
Yes, and this goes full circle to what we said before.
Yeah. Just discussing the economy in those real terms would be a pleasure.
Yes. So we were talking astronomy with each other, with the sun at the middle of the solar system. We wouldn't necessarily agree on it all, but at least we got the position of the planets right. That would be nice. MMT doesn't solve all the problems, but at least it gives us a framework to provide the solutions. Currently, we've got no framework to provide any solutions, and we need that framework. But it can come. We have made great progress, you know, and I am very positive about the work you guys do has been awesome. You know, and if I can help you in any way, you know I'll always do it, even short notice. If you ever need me to do anything, I'm there if I can help.
Thanks, Phil. I think that's a great place to leave it. We've been talking to Dr. Phil Armstrong, economist, author of Can Heterodox Economics Make a Difference? We'll link to the things that came up in this conversation, but also all the things that keep you in touch with Phil and his work in the show notes. But for now, thanks so much for joining us today on the MMT podcast, Dr. Phil Armstrong.
Thanks, Christian. Thanks, Patricia.
That was the MMT podcast with Patricia Pino and Christian Riley. Don't forget, you can support the show through Patreon, starting at $1 a month, and get access to patron-only episodes. You can do that by going to patreon.com/MMTpodcast. You can also find me on Twitter at @MMTpodcast, and you can find Patricia on Twitter at Patricia N. Pino, and you can email us at mmtpodcast@outlook.com. Thanks for listening, and we hope to hear from you.